Space as you've never seen it before. After a quarter century in development on Earth, the world's most powerful space telescope is now in orbit in space, about a million miles away. And this summer, it released its stunning first images. The James Webb Space Telescope is an extraordinary scientific achievement built to see parts of space and time previously unseen, like this image of a galaxy cluster as it appeared 4.6 billion years ago. And the expectation is that the Webb will be able to look even further back in time to the early universe and the formation of its first stars and galaxies. Mike Menzel is the lead mission systems engineer at NASA for the Webb Space Telescope. He joins me now. Mike, thank you. Let me first just ask your reaction to these images. As somebody who's worked so hard and for so long on this, what are you seeing and what does it make you, you know, is this better than you expected? Pretty much the same? What's your reaction?
Well, the reaction of myself and all my colleagues was of sheer joyful amazement. You know, the images that you see are great, but the amount of detail that's in these images astounded us.
Are there any images in particular you want to direct our attention to?
Yeah, it's the one, the galaxy cluster that you had talked about. It's a galaxy cluster about 4 billion light years away. And that image, the thing that made us almost giddy when we saw it, the image actually contains galaxies in it that are farther away than Hubble imaged. But at first reaction, you can look at that image and think to yourself, well, it looks similar to Hubble. But the Hubble picture, the Hubble took 10 to 15 days to get that image. We did it in 12 hours. So this was a taste of things to come. And when we saw that image, we all kind of, you know, we were literally, as I said, giddy. We designed this telescope to see the very first galaxies that turned on in the universe. And when we saw what it did in only 12 hours, we knew in our hearts that whatever's out there, we're going to see it.
So when I think about this as a layman, what strikes me as extraordinary about this telescope is on the one side, it faces the sun and has this, the heat that it's facing is extraordinary. On the other side, it's facing cold temperatures like you can't imagine. Describe how that works.
The sun shield blocks out the sun and lets the cold side passively cool down to almost the temperature of cold space, to the temperature of the telescope. The 3 metric tons of that telescope has to get down to about 55 degrees Kelvin, which is about minus 361 degrees Fahrenheit. It has to do that because we're looking in infrared wavelengths. Anything that has a temperature like our bodies, like ambient temperature, would glow in the infrared. So we don't want the telescope glowing brighter than these images that it's looking at. So that big tennis court-sized sun shield that we have keeps us in the shade and allows us to cool. And I've told people, if that sun shield were suntan lotion, you would say it had an SPF of about 10 million.
Wow. And when you think about what this will help us learn, how should we think about what a telescope like this teaches us? I mean, you know, and again, I hear it as a layman, I think, so are we going to learn a lot more about the Big Bang because we're going back so far in time?
Well, it could potentially tell us some of the conditions in the early universe that could make some inferences as to the Big Bang, but it will certainly tell us what the early universe was like, how that early universe fostered galaxy formation. And the other big question that Webb is fully capable of answering is looking for planets around other stars, exoplanets, that may have signs of biomarkers, signs of elements or compounds that either are produced by life or necessary for life. So when you think about it, it's possibly, you know, addressing two of the most fundamental questions in astronomy. How did it all begin? And are we alone?
So when I think of it up there, a million miles away, I guess I have two questions. One, what happens if something goes wrong? What happens if you run out of gas or fuel or energy or whatever it is that's powering it?
Well, first, let me answer the last question because that's the easiest. We had designed the telescope to be good, to have enough fuel, propellant, for 10 years. Well, as it is, because Ariane put us on such a perfect trajectory, and because we made some of our early maneuvers right on time, we have well over 20 years of propellant. So we're, propellant is not our problem there. And when it comes to what could go wrong, well, anything can go wrong in space. And we designed contingency procedures for that. But most of us believed, most of us were fairly certain, that the biggest risks that we faced were in the early days of the deploying, the unfolding. And that went so smoothly and so great that most of us feel, hey, most of our major risks are behind us right now. We have a fully operational world asset for astronomy.
So when I look at something like this, Mike, it does seem to me you and your colleagues play a very special role. There's so much bad news out there. There's so much that people worry about. And then here you come along with this astonishing scientific and technological achievement. It's a sign of what the American government, when it puts its mind to it, can do really well. But it's also a sign of real international cooperation, right? Because this is not just an American venture.
Absolutely. This is an international collaboration involving the Canadian and European space agencies, various universities. And it, as you said, it does show when we can work collegially what we can do together. And over the course of, 25 years, myself, a lot of my foreign partners, we became like family. So we ended up squabbling, but I was always squabbling with someone who I knew was as dedicated to the success of this mission as I was. And we got through it all together, and, well, you can see the results.
Well, I have to tell you, this is the kind of thing that leaves me always amazed and in awe, but also very grateful. Grateful for all the work you guys have done. So thank you, and it's been a pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you, sir.